Hello. In the previous video, we talked about how field-oriented control, or FOC, regulates the current in a BLDC or PMSM motor. In this episode, we will go deeper and learn how to determine the proper values of KP and KI for the current control loop so that the current response matches the desired bandwidth. We will discuss the concept of bandwidth, how to find KP and KI mathematically, how to measure the motor resistance and inductance, and finally test it directly on this DIY BLDC driver. In short, the core idea of field-oriented control is to control the sinusoidal current in the direct and quadrature frames, or simply the D and Q axis. The purpose of having a PI controller in FOC is simple. We want the current to follow the reference as fast and as accurately as possible. When we give a current reference or set point, the PI controller will generate the proper voltage so that the actual motor current matches that reference. However, because the motor winding has inductance and resistance, the current cannot instantly change when voltage is applied. It rises gradually due to the inductive nature of the winding. Here, the proportional part of the controller provides a large voltage when the actual current is below the set point and reduces it when the current approaches the target. Meanwhile, the integral part keeps increasing the voltage until the current reaches the reference level. But how do we find KP and KI? We could use trial and error or other tuning methods, but here we will determine them using a mathematical approach. In the next few minutes, we will unleash all the math skills we have ever learned. A BLDC or PMSM motor, and even a brushed DC motor in a stationary condition, can be modeled as a simple circuit with resistance and inductance. Let's assume that V is the output from the PI controller. From the circuit, we can write the equation like this. Here, R is the resistance, L is the inductance, and I is the current. When we move to the S domain, the equation becomes I of S divided by V of S equals 1 divided by LS plus R. We will store this as M, which represents the transfer function of the motor. Since the current control is a closed-loop system, the transfer function of the entire system can be written as G of S equals C of S times M of S, divided by 1 plus C of S times M of S. Here, C is the PI controller with the function, KP plus KI divided by S. When we substitute both the controller and the motor plan into the equation, we get the equation like this. Now we have the closed-loop transfer function. If we observe it carefully, this system has two components, one from the motor and one from the PI controller. The motor has a pole at negative R over L, while the PI controller introduces a zero at negative KI over KP. In simple terms, the pole causes a delay and slows down the system, while the zero counteracts that delay. To make the system simpler and easier to control, we use the method called pole zero cancellation. By making the zero cancel out the pole, we set their positions equal. This gives us the relationship between KP and KI as KI equals KP multiplied by R divided by L. Using this relationship, we can simplify our second-order system into a first-order system by substitution. So it becomes like this. The standard form of a first-order system is G of S equals omega C divided by S plus omega C. By comparing both forms, we can see that omega C equals KP divided by L. From this, we find KP equals omega C multiplied by L. And since KI equals KP multiplied by R divided by L, we can also write KI equals omega C multiplied by R. This is a very simple and practical result, where omega C is the angular frequency of the bandwidth we choose. Or in another form, omega C equals 2 times pi times FC, where FC is the desired bandwidth frequency. Earlier, we mentioned how the inductance slows down the current response when a voltage is applied. Imagine that we already have the PI controller. If we apply a sinusoidal reference current with a low frequency, the actual current can still follow it. But as we increase the frequency, the current begins to lag behind, and its amplitude becomes smaller. If we plot the current amplitude response versus the frequency of the reference signal, we get a curve like this. The bandwidth is defined as the frequency where the response drops by 3 decibels from the ideal value. That bandwidth represents how fast the control loop can follow changes in the reference. After understanding bandwidth, we just need to input the motor's resistance and inductance values so we can obtain the desired KP and KI values. Some motors list these resistance and inductance values in their data sheets, but if not, we need to measure them manually using an accurate RCL meter. If you don't have one, there is an alternative way to measure the motor's R and L values using a function generator and an oscilloscope, as I will do to measure my motor here. The scenario is like this. We need to wire the motor so that one motor coil is connected in series with 2 other coils which are wired in parallel. Then, we connect it in series with a resistor whose value is known. Let's call it RS. In this experiment, I'm using an RS of 10 ohms. Then we connect it to the function generator, so the circuit will look like this. What we need to do is capture the signal from the function generator and also the signal across the motor with the oscilloscope. Now, after the circuit is connected, the next step is to take measurements using a 2-channel oscilloscope. Channel 1 will be connected to the function generator's output signal, while channel 2 will be connected to the voltage at the motor terminals, right after RS. With this configuration, we can observe the relationship between the total voltage and the voltage across the motor, which we will later use to calculate the current, impedance, and finally obtain the R and L values of the motor. Next, we set the function generator to produce a sinusoidal signal with a frequency of, for example, 1 kHz and an amplitude of around 2 volts peak to peak. This small amplitude is safe enough to prevent excessive current or saturation in the motor. Once the signal is running, 2 sine waves will appear on the oscilloscope screen, 1 from the generator and 1 from the motor. From here, we will see that the signal at the motor is phase shifted or lags behind the input signal. Well, this phase difference indicates the inductive component of the motor. The next step is to measure the phase difference and the amplitude of these 2 signals. We can use the cursors on the oscilloscope to measure the time difference between the 0 crossing of the CH1 signal and the CH2 signal. We call this time difference delta T. By knowing the signal frequency, we can calculate the phase difference in degrees using this equation. Phase in radians equals delta T times 2 pi times F. Next, from the amplitude difference between the function generator output voltage and the voltage across the motor, we can calculate the current flowing in the circuit. Since the resistor RS is connected in series with the motor, it carries the same current, which can be calculated as V channel 1 minus V channel 2 divided by RS. Then, the total impedance of the motor is equal to V channel 2 divided by I. Based on the phasor diagram, we obtain the general equation for the RL circuit. By utilizing these 2 equations, we can find the motor's R and L values, where R equals Z times cosine of phi, and L equals Z times sine of phi divided by omega. In this way, we can directly obtain the resistance and inductance values of the motor using just an oscilloscope and a function generator, without needing an accurate RCL meter. After performing the measurements and calculations, the resistance value obtained was 0.276 ohms and the inductance was 135 millihenries. After we have the R and L values, we can directly calculate KP and KI. Here, I will try with a bandwidth of 50 Hz. I obtained a KP value of 0.042412 and a KI value of 86.70796. These values are then entered into the PI controller. I will test it by giving a 1 ampere step input to the ID current and reading the current with a sampling time of 10 kHz. The USB will then output log current data every 100 microseconds. I copy all of this data and paste it into Excel, marking the ID values at 10% and 90% of the set point. From this, the rise time is obtained as 6.6 milliseconds. The bandwidth can be calculated from 0.35 divided by the rise time in seconds. This results in a bandwidth of 53.0303 Hz, which has a difference of 3.0303 Hz from the desired bandwidth. I tried several different bandwidth variants, and here are the results. The results are quite good, very close to the desired bandwidth value. We can see here that when the bandwidth is increased, the current response becomes faster at following the reference. And that's how we determine KP and KI from the motor's resistance, inductance, and the desired bandwidth. In the next video, we will talk about how this entire process can be automated, a method known as self-commissioning, which removes the need to measure resistance and inductance manually. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next episode.